Chairman Takano, Ranking Member Bost, members of the committee, on behalf of the Anti-Defamation League, the ADL, I appreciate the opportunity to discuss the landscape of domestic extremism and related efforts to recruit and attract veterans. Domestic violent extremism impacts the safety and security of all Americans, but understanding the specific danger it poses to our democratic institutions is a key to mitigating the threat. While extremist movements pose many problems to society, from spreading hate and intolerance to engaging in deadly violence, it is also concerning when adherents of extreme causes target the institutions dedicated to protecting the people of the United States. It's not lost on the American public that of the 600 or so individuals arrested for their role in the January 6th insurrection, over 50, at least over 50, were veterans, or that we have seen veterans become leaders of extremist groups, train extremists, and even engage in extremist violence. We continue to observe and document how extremist groups and movements seek to target veterans for recruitment. How and why they do that depends in part on the ideology. The nature of potential indicators varies from movement to movement, and sometimes even within a movement. We have seen a range of white supremacist groups express interest in adding veterans to their ranks because of their military skills and training, including violent paramilitary white supremacist groups like The Base and Adam Waffen, whose members participate in training camps to refine their survivalist tactics in preparation for a perceived impending race war. The membership application for The Base explicitly targets those with, quote, military experience, unquote. And in a February 2019, the group's founder and leader tweeted, quote, "Why do we ask applicants about military experience? The Base is survivalism and self-defense network, two skills that are acquired through military training," unquote. As mentioned earlier, members of the anti-government extremist Oath Keepers focus on recruiting military as well as police by exploiting their career-related oaths to uphold and defend the Constitution. One of the militia's main area of focus is firearms and military-style training. They recruit former military because they hope they have the range of skills and expertise in subjects such as survival, reconnaissance, hand-to-hand combat. These skills can be used to train others. There are also Proud Boys who present themselves as a pseudo-paramilitary group and consistently engage in violent confrontations around the country. They include members who are veterans, some who hold leadership positions. We also know that violence is not the sole domain of any one extremist movement and is an issue across the ideological spectrum. Some left-wing extremist efforts to push back against those they oppose have at times served to normalize violence as well. But we also know that 75% of extremist-related murders in the United States, according to our data, over the past 10 years, have been carried out by right-wing extremists. We are seeing how extremists use the language of patriotism to further their reach, wrapping their agendas in the stars and stripes. And this language finds voice on a variety of social media and online platforms, providing a fertile environment for the hate, conspiracies, and disinformation to proliferate in so-called patriot groups and other spaces that animate real-world activity. To mitigate the threat of extremism, we must understand efforts to recruit our veterans, as well as our military and law enforcement more broadly, not just because of the erosion of trust that it creates, but because they have an outsized negative impact on the safety of our communities. We must also pay attention to the broader changing landscape of extremism, whether it's harassment or threats against school boards, elected officials, or healthcare workers. The front line against extremist activity and action is local. It is close to home, trying to creep into our institutions, eager to prey upon our heroes and our vulnerable. The issues of extremism in the veteran community is complex. And in closing, I urge the committee to consider how the Department of Veteran Affairs and related agencies can become better informed on the threat of extremists' attempts to recruit our nation's veterans, to help veterans in transition become more aware of those risks and consider how we can help bolster veteran resilience in the face of attempted recruitment and radicalization. As we explore what can work, what has worked, and what is needed, we can better prepare America's veterans to reject extremist efforts to conscript them into the cause of hate and violence. Thank you for your time.